It goes by Belladonna, the deadly nightshade. While it's a classic symbol of beauty, every part of it can kill you. Its berries and leaves can cause hallucinations or extreme psychological symptoms when eaten, and a little too much can kill you quickly. Belladonna has a reputation in multiple cultures as the queen of poisons, whether it was snuck into a king's meal or on the end of a poison-tipped arrow. But the same compounds in this plant that can cause such unpredictable and deadly effects are also used as life-saving medications, including as an antidote to poisoning. For centuries, this plant was deemed too dangerous to study. So how did this plant shed its reputation and end up in emergency kits? This is the story of how belladonna became medicine. Belladonna itself is a small shrub that grows from about 1.5 to 2 meters tall. It has beautiful purple, bell-shaped flowers and a dark purple berry about the size of a blueberry. And while it grows all over the world, it's found mostly from Western Asia to Northern Africa to Europe. We don't know exactly when, but at some point in the ancient world, people realized that belladonna was poisonous. Little kids can die from a dose of 0.2 milligrams per kilogram of body weight, which is only about 2 berries. And on average, 90 to 130 milligrams is enough to kill an adult, but its lethal dose varies widely. One man even got belladonna poisoning from eating a rabbit that had recently eaten belladonna. So of course, we figured out how to weaponize it. As far back as ancient Greece and Rome, people snuck it into food and wine as a long-acting, agonizing poison. But early on, they noticed a wide range of toxic effects if it didn't kill you. On the mild end, it caused constipation, flushing, and dry mouth, and enough of it could cause delirium, hallucinations, coma, and of course, death, which is a pretty bad side effect. Some cultures even harness these hallucinogenic effects, like the ancient Romans during Bacchanalia, these buck-wild drunken festivals. Then in the Middle Ages, would-be witches and warlocks use it to make mind-altering potions. Now, even though belladonna was a known poison, cultures in Europe, Western Asia, and Africa took their chances on it as a medicine. They used it as a painkiller, diuretic, as a treatment for spasms, joint pain, nerve pain, gout, for fever, epilepsy, cancer, mania, and as a way to dilate the pupils. In fact, young Italian women in the 1500s had a reputation for using belladonna to make their eyes look bigger and more beautiful, which is where the modern name comes from, pretty woman. And these effects can last a long time. Chemicals in belladonna can slow down gastric emptying, effectively creating a slow-release medication. But why? Belladonna belongs to the nightshade family, which is the same family as potatoes, but includes other poisonous plants like mandrake, henbane, and datura. And they all poison people the same way, through effects on the nervous system. These plants have a few different alkaloid compounds that inhibit the action of a chemical called acetylcholine, a chemical that allows nerves to communicate with each other, also known as a neurotransmitter. And depending on which of these compounds you're talking about, they might affect different parts of the body. Like scopolamine is more active in the eyes and central nervous system, while atropine, the main alkaloid of interest for belladonna, is more active in the intestines, the muscles around the bronchi in your lungs, and the heart, which is what makes it so deadly. In fact, belladonna was so strongly associated with death that its genus, Atropa, and that main alkaloid, atropine, were named after the Greek fate Atropos, the one who cut the string of life. Its reputation was so well established by the mid-19th century that a popular gardening textbook specifically warned against belladonna, but gave cultivation instructions for other poisonous nightshade. Even pharmacology textbooks have purposely omitted entries on belladonna because it was so severely toxic. In this way, belladonna was one of the earliest things that could be considered a controlled substance, which is typically reserved for addictive drugs with no medical benefit. But of course, there were some holdouts that kept using it medicinally. A Scottish pharmacist named Andrew Duncan wrote about it in 1803, saying that plants in the genus Atropa could be used against things like several febrile illnesses, particularly the plague, gout, and in nervous diseases such as palsy, apoplexy, epilepsy, chin cough or whooping cough, hydrophobia, melancholy, mania, jaundice, and cancer. As far as how much, he recommended starting out with a little bit of powdered leaves or root and increasing the dosage over time. And eventually, we decided to get a more scientific basis. It was, after all, still a poison. In 1819, a chemist named Brandis isolated the chemical atropine from the belladonna root. And that was a great first step because now physicians could give a precise amount of the active ingredient, the thing in a medicine that actually has the medicinal effect. Remember, belladonna has multiple compounds that have different effects on different organs. so medicating with one known compound is much safer, and it keeps us from using a whole plant with who knows what else in it. And isolating atropine allowed physicians to use it in more medical applications. Eye surgeons would use a topical atropine solution to dilate and paralyze the muscles around the pupils, which would allow them to examine the retina and surgically remove cataracts more easily. Fast forward to 1867, and two German scientists showed that atropine blocked the cardiac effects of vagal stimulation, meaning it could speed up a heart rate that had slowed down. Scientists also looked into belladonna while studying the pathophysiology of asthma and as a potential treatment for Parkinson's, neither of which worked. Then in 1901, a chemist named Richard Willstatter synthesized atropine in the lab, and isolating and synthesizing the active ingredient allows scientists to study medicine more precisely. But before we entered the modern age of atropine, belladonna had a brief stint as a topical cure-all. In the late 19th, early 20th century, you could buy plasters infused with belladonna that you'd stick on your body for everything from back pain, gout, neuralgia, anything, kind of like a modern day icy hot patch. By the way, I did a quick search for belladonna plasters online, and they still exist, but only as a brand name. They actually just have camphor and menthol in them. By the 20th century, doctors had stopped focusing on the plant and started focusing on atropine. The only place that belladonna really persists is in some complementary and alternative medicines, including homeopathy. For those unfamiliar, homeopathy is a pseudoscience where you drop an active ingredient in water, then take a drop of that, dilute it in more water, and repeat the dilution process hundreds of times, which is supposed to make it more powerful. Not surprisingly, it doesn't work. So how does atropine work? Well, I collaborated with my friends over at BioZone over on their channel to explain the pharmacology and receptor physiology at work here. Consider that like a deep dive into the science that accompanies the history here. In short though, atropine increases sympathetic activity, the side of your autonomic nervous system that speeds up heart rate. The most straightforward use for it is for symptomatic bradycardia. Brady meaning slow, cardia meaning heart rate. This isn't the same as a fit athlete having a low heart rate, but for when low heart rate happens alongside something else. Atropine is also useful in specific types of heart block, a condition where the electrical signals in the heart aren't conducting like normal. Outside of the heart, atropine can decrease salivation and secretions from the respiratory system, which is especially useful before surgeries with inhaled anesthesia. Some anesthesias can irritate people's airways, and this helps calm things down. Finally, and I think this is the most beautiful irony, atropine is on the World Health Organization's list of essential medicines as an antidote to poisoning, specifically as an antidote to organophosphates, or nerve gases, that slow down heart rate. Atropine is the antidote that speeds up heart rate again. By the way, the story of how we started using that antidote is amazing, and I can't wait to tell it to you, but it's a story for another time. Now, if you want to learn even more about how atropine does these things to the body, check out this video from BioZone where April breaks down the pharmacology of atropine as we know it today. And if you like this video, I've got more like it ready to upload, so subscribe and hit the bell icon so you get notified when I post a new video. Have fun, be good. Thanks for watching.